In today's lecture, we're going to talk about convexity in the context of optimization. Now, in deep learning, the functions that we optimize are typically not convex. So convex functions are functions that have very beneficial properties, such as every local optimum is also a global optimum. However, understanding convex functions helps us to analyze optimization algorithms. So short introductions to convexity is also important to deep learning. The property of convexity is related to convex sets. A set X is said to be convex if for any two elements A and B from this set X, the line segment connecting A and B, so if A is here, B is here, the line segment connecting A and B is also contained in this set X. Mathematically, this means that for all lambdas between 0 and 1, that lambda times A plus 1 minus lambda times B, so the sum of this, we change lambda, we can move on the line segment between A and B, needs to be in X for every A and B that are also in X. So any A and B in this convex set, the line segment between these two points is in the set. And here you clearly see what that means. Here we have a counterexample where the line segment between these two points is not in the set. You see that convex sets typically don't have these cavities, or generally don't have these cavities. Say that we have two convex sets, X and Y, then the intersection is also a convex set. This can be very easily proven, because if A and B are two points that are in this intersection, that clearly means that they're also in X and at the same time in Y. And if X and Y are two convex sets, that also means that the line segments between A and B are contained in both X and both Y, because X and Y are both convex. So for the intersection, the same thing needs to hold, which proves that the intersection of two convex sets is also a convex set. And here we see an example. A and B, and here is A intersected with B. This theorem can be generalized to the intersection of any number of convex sets just by induction. By adding one set at a time, you get a new convex set, you add another one, and so on. However, the converse is not true. So the union of two convex sets is not convex. As a counterexample, take two disjoint sets, then while the intersection, the empty set is a convex set, their union would not be, because if they do not intersect and we pick one point A in X and another point B in Y, then the line between these does not lie in the union. Based on convex sets, we can now define convex functions. So starting with a convex set X, a function that has as domain this convex set. So it's a function that we can take any element from X and get a value, function value out in R in this case. This function is convex if, again, for any pair of points from this convex set and for any points on the line segment, so for all lambda element 0 to 1, the f evaluated at this element in the line segment yields a smaller or equal function value to, well, this convex combination, basically taking this weighted average between the two function values. So what this means is that if I have my point x here and x prime here for this function, then for any point on this line segment between x and x prime, the function is smaller or equal to the line segment between the two function values. So this line here connecting the two function values. Here we see an example of a non-convex function, where this is obviously not true. And here we see another example of a convex function. So this is the exponential function. Here we see the cosinus. The cosinus is a non-convex function. A parabola is a convex function. One property that convex functions have is that every local optimum is a global optimum. So every local minimum is a global minimum. Doesn't need to be that there is only one minimum, because the function could, for example, be flat in a region but still be convex. Then every point here in this flat region could be a local and a global optimum at the same time. And it doesn't even need to be that it even has a minimum. For example, if we look at the exponential function, it doesn't obtain the minimum. So if we plug in minus infinity or let it go to minus infinity, it only approaches zero. The nice thing is that if we minimize functions, because they only have global minima, if they have minima, we cannot get stuck in local optima. As we said, there might be multiple global optima. For example, this function here, which is the maximum of the absolute value of x minus 1 and 0, the function it looks like this, has many local minima in this and global minima in this region here, which is minus 1 through 1. And for example, the exponential function does not attain a minimum value in R. It only asymptotes to 0. Convex functions have convex below set. So what is the below set of a function? Well, the below set of a function is the set of points. So it's a set of x, element capital X, where capital X is the domain of the function. So X is it's already a convex set in the case of convex function. And the set of points here that have a function value smaller than some constant B. The below set of B, SB, the set of X from the domain of F, that have a function value smaller or equal to B. And if F is a convex function, which means that also X is a convex set, then all of these below sets are also convex sets. So we can prove convexity of these below sets quickly. So say we have 2 point X and X prime from the below set SB of a convex function and some lambda between 0, 1, then, well, the function value of x and the function value of x prime both are smaller or equal to b. Otherwise, x and x prime wouldn't be in this SB set. Thus, if we take lambda times f of x plus 1 minus lambda f of x prime, the sum also needs to be smaller or equal to b, because each of those is bounded above by b. Now, if we take the function value of lambda x plus 1 minus lambda x prime, so if we evaluate the function at this line segment between x and x prime, because f is a convex function, this is smaller or equal to the combination of these function values. thus it's also smaller or equal to b, and thus the whole line segment is also an element of SB, meaning that SB is a convex set. In this example here, we have a non-convex function. So we have these below sets here for different b. So the darker the color here, the smaller the value of b. Sometimes we would like to minimize the function f of x subject to a number of constraints that we can define on these values of x. Then the way we would write that is we would minimize f of x over x subject to a number of constraints functions ci of x, and these constraint functions we typically write such that they are smaller or equal to zero. This is usually not a restriction because we can always find for some constraint function a different ci such that the constraint is smaller or equal to zero. For example, we would like the parameters to lie in a ball, which in this case would mean that c1 of x equals to the L2 norm of x minus 1. So this here is the size of the ball. So if we say this is basically in x1 and here is x2, then we look at the L2 ball. Then if we want our x to lie in this ball, so let's say this is the L2 ball, the L2 ball with size 1. So every point in this ball has an L2 norm smaller than 1. Then we get such a constraint that compares the constraint function with 0 by subtracting the size of the ball. Or we might want to constrain these values x to lie in a half space. So we want to minimize over x values. Say we have some function that has a minimum here, and then it has some level sets. So the further we go away from this minimum, the larger the function gets. So these level sets correspond to points that have the same function value. And we want to minimize it such that the points lie in this half space here. Yeah. So we want to exclude any point that is here, which also includes the minimum. Then it would basically yield this point here, which achieves a small function value, but basically lies in this half space that is defined by this line here. Or if we put both of these constraint functions, we can also at the same time say, well, we want to satisfy both a ball constraint, so which is a constraint on the norm of this value, and a half space constraint. So this would basically look like this and would yield the same optimum in this case. Now, think of this example as the function value to be a form a force that wants x to go to the minimum during optimization. And then you can think of these constraints as a wall that you put. For example, here the half space constraint clearly is a wall that you put here. And then you start by putting a ball somewhere here and you let it roll towards the minimum based on the gradient of this function. Then this point where the gradient is observed, you can think of the the gradient of this constraint function to cancel with the gradient of the objective function. So the point where the ball then goes stays for to halt, as it comes to a halt, these two gradients exactly cancel. And this analogy allows us to derive the so-called Lagrange function L. So the Lagrange function basically takes our function that we want to minimize and adds to it all the constraint functions. And it doesn't just add the constraint functions as they are, but it gives them non-negative weights alpha I. So you basically have a weighted sum of all your CIs, all of these constraint functions. And these alpha I's are so-called Lagrange multiplier that ensure that the constraint is properly enforced. So they are set just large enough such that the constraint function will be smaller or equal to zero for all I if you minimize the Lagrange function. Now in deep learning, typically we don't solve a constraint problems exactly. In fact, we actually never really solve optimization problems exactly. But we typically only aim for approximate solutions, also of this Lagrange function. So in deep learning, thus we don't really get too caught up with satisfying these constraint functions completely, but rather just in practice just find some alpha I such that we can add these constraints to the objective function. For example, you can think of weight decay. So regularization with a norm of the parameters is a form of constraint optimization where the regularizer lambda half times the L2 norm of your, or the squared L2 norm of your weight vector ensures that these entries in the weight vector doesn't grow too large. That is a form of regularization. And this L2 regularization really is equivalent to a norm constraint such that basically W lies in some L2 ball with radius R. Now this radius doesn't need to be 1 as before, but is basically an unknown. But sort of each value of lambda would correspond to some unknown value of R. So this is more an analogy than defining an exact ball. But it basically helps you to think that if you apply weight decay, this is equivalent to defining some constraint on the norm, that the norm lies in some ball, and you use the Lagrange multiplier method to minimize this function. And if we change the value of lambda, this implies that this radius R is also changed, which allows us to vary the size of a parameter vector W. Another way to enforce constraints are projections on a convex set. So say you want your parameters to lie in some convex set, you can minimize your function and after each optimization step, for example, project your parameter into this convex set. For example, if you want to have your x always be in some norm, you can go about and basically project your x on your unconstrained x onto the closest point in this convex set. So for example, if you wanted your point x to lie in this L2 ball here, then, well, if the point is already in this L2 ball, nothing happens. However, if the point is outside the L2 ball, you would project it back to the closest point inside the ball, which would be this, the tip of this red arrow here. Similarly, for an L1 ball, if your point already lies in this L1 ball, nothing happens. If your point is outside, you can project it to the closest point that lies in this L1 ball. And for L2 balls, generally the direction of this projection would be unchanged. Only the norm would be changed. And for L1 ball, the direction would be changed because you're basically zeroing out this one component here. One example of projections that is applied in deep learning optimization, for example, is gradient clipping, where in each iteration of your optimization, you want your gradient to be bounded in its norm. So you would take the gradient and project it back onto, for example, some norm ball, L1 ball or an L2 ball, depending on the type of norm that you would like. So you project it back onto a ball with some radius C. So to summarize, in the context of deep learning, the main purpose of these convex functions is to motivate optimization algorithms and help us to understand them. So remember, deep learning objectives are typically not convex functions because our models are so complex, and thus our loss functions are very convex and have many local optima. However, they do help us to better understand our optimization algorithms. Second, intersections of convex functions are also convex. Unions of convex functions are not. If we have a function that is twice differentiable, then it is convex if and only if all the eigenvalues of the Hessian matrix are larger or equal to zeros. So if they're all non-negative. So this is a good way to check if some function is convex. And it needs to be the case for the Hessian or the second derivative at any point on the domain. So that's not always easy to check. If we have a function that we want to minimize and we want to add convex constraints, that we can do via the Lagrange function. And in practice, these Lagrange functions result in a penalized version of this function. And weight decay can be thought of some form of a constraint optimization problem. Similarly, we can use projections to map points onto a convex set. So we would use non-constrained optimizations, but always take a point if it leaves the set that we would like to it to be in, and project it back into the set. And with this, I want to say thank you and goodbye. See you next time.